Welcome to our service for Sunday the 20th of February. We start with the song, Is He Worthy?
Do you feel the world is broken? Do you feel the shadows deepen? But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? Do you wish that you could see it all made new? Is all creation groaning? Coming, is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Is anyone
Let us pray. Eternal and everlasting God, you came to our world in Christ. You shared in our humanity. You walked with us. you still come to us through the presence of your Spirit, sharing in our experiences each and every day, speaking into our lives, for you are ever with us. May we recognize your presence with us now as we come to you in worship, for we know nothing can separate us from your love, and whether we are together with others or apart, we are still part of the body of Christ. So as we come to you in worship, to hear your word and listen to your voice, open our eyes to your presence in our lives, and open our lives to your grace and power. We come celebrating the awesomeness of your love and the wonder of your grace. Even though we fail you time and time again, you never walk away and you never fail us. Undeserving though we are, you show us mercy. We thank you that you do not turn away in the moments our faith is feeble, in the moments when we doubt, or when we are hesitant disciples, reluctant to share your word with others for fear of what that might mean for us. God of never-ending patience, even in the times we fail you, you understand our weaknesses and help us to put our faults behind us. You lift us up when we have fallen from grace and help us to start again. We offer so little, yet you give us so much. Our love is so weak, yet you respond richly. May we continue to celebrate the wonders of your grace and find our life renewed in you. We would say in the words you taught us, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever. Amen. Our first reading today is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 26, reading from verses 26 to 29, hearing it from the Good News Bible. While they were eating, Jesus took a piece of bread, gave a prayer of thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples. Take and eat it, he said. This is my body. Then he took a cup, gave thanks to God, and gave it to them. Drink it, all of you, he said. This is my blood, which seals God's covenant, my blood poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will never again drink this wine until the day I drink the new wine with you in my Father's kingdom. And then turning to the last book of the Bible, Revelation chapter 21, reading from verses 1 to 4. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The first heaven and the first earth disappeared, and the sea vanished. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared and ready, like a bride dressed to meet her husband. I heard a loud voice speaking from the throne. Now God's home is with people. He will live with them, and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them, and he will be their God. He will wipe away all tears from their eyes. There will be no more death, no more grief or crying or pain. The old things have disappeared. At the heart of the Bible is a love story, a divine romance. It fills the Old Testament, where the nation of Israel is seen as wedded to Jehovah, though with many heartaches and failures along the way. And it stretches throughout the New, where the church is revealed to be the bride of Christ. God's intention right from the Garden of Eden was to have a people separated for himself, a bride. The Apostle John was given a vision of that wonderful day, Revelation 21 verses 2 to 4. I saw the holy city, the New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. But before we get ahead of ourselves, let's back up a step. You see, to understand the Lord's plan in receiving a bride for himself, we must understand the steps involved in a Jewish wedding in those days. Jesus often spoke of weddings in his parables, and by gaining insight into earthly Jewish marriage practices, we can see wonderful truths and implications for our heavenly union with the Lord. Let us explore these things. Most marriages in those days were arranged marriages, and it was normally the father of the groom who would initiate the selection of the bride for his son by contacting the woman's father. Genesis 24 contains an example of this, where Abraham sends his servant to find a bride for his son Isaac. But most often the son would go with his father to meet with the father of his potential bride. The father of the girl would then ask what the groom was willing to pay for his daughter. Using the example of Genesis 24, we see that gifts were given to Rebecca and her family to pay this price. Once the father of the bride was satisfied with the proposals, his daughter would be called in. And if she agreed to the marriage, a contract was written up which gave the responsibilities to each party and the agreed price to be paid. This process was completed by the two of them, drinking wine from a shared cup. And even though the marriage ceremony was still to take place in the future, it was now a legal and binding marriage. This completed the betrothal phase of the marriage. It was more binding than our engagement. Thus, for instance, when Joseph found Mary was pregnant, he planned to quietly divorce her. Divorce was necessary to break the betrothal agreement. The groom would at this stage return to his father's house to prepare a place for his bride. Most often this involved building a new room onto his father's house, as she would be coming to join his family. It was normally about a year later, or more if they were betrothed as children, before he finally returned for his bride. But it was up to the bridegroom's father to decide when the room was ready to receive the bride. So the bridegroom never knew exactly when that time would be. During that year, the girl would be preparing herself for marriage, acquiring the skills she would require to take her place in her new home. Normally, in that year, they wouldn't have any contact with one another. But usually, after about a year, when the groom's father had given the go-ahead, the bridegroom would gather together his groomsmen and head off for the bride's house. The normal time to arrive there been half an hour before midnight. As they went down the street, they would be shouting and blowing trumpets to celebrate the joyous occasion and give the bride warning that he was on his way. When they arrived, she would gather her stuff and head off to the bridegroom's house with her bridesmaids, who would be carrying lighted lamps. At the bridegroom's house, there would be a short marriage ceremony with close family and a few friends. At the wedding, the bride and groom would again share a cup of wine together, for the first time since the betrothal covenant had been made. This would lead on to their first night together and the consummation of their marriage. Then the following day, the community would be called to a wedding feast at the father's house, the start of 7 days of celebrations for the newly married couple, a time of dancing, singing, feasting, and great joy for all. The representation of Jesus as the bridegroom is present in quite a few places in the New Testament. In fact, it is John the Baptist who first uses the term. In John 3 verses 28 to 30, John declares, "You yourselves are my witnesses that I said, I am not the Messiah, but I have been sent ahead of him. The bridegroom is the one to whom the bride belongs. But the bridegroom's friend, who stands by and listens, is glad when he hears the bridegroom's voice. This is how my own happiness is made complete. He must become more important, while I become less important." And then in Matthew 9, verses 14 and 15. Then the followers of John the Baptist came to Jesus asking, "Why is it that we and the Pharisees fast often, but your disciples don't fast at all?" Jesus answered, "Do you expect the guests at a wedding party to be sad as long as the bridegroom is with them? Of course not. But the day will come when the bridegroom will be taken away from them, and then they will fast." It's also interesting that the first occasion where Jesus performed a miracle, according to the Apostle John, was at a wedding. The wedding at Cana in Galilee, John chapter 2, where Jesus changed water into wine. It was as if Jesus was saying, "It's time to put away the old jars filled with ordinary, insipid water. I'm not only going to fill them with wine that gladdens the heart. I'm going to fill them with wine that symbolizes the cleansing, redeeming power of my blood and announces a new covenant. I'm bringing in the new wine of the kingdom." But to move on to actual echoes of the Jewish marriage ceremony. At the Last Supper, we read, "Then Jesus took a piece of bread, gave thanks to God, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in memory of me.' In the same way, he gave them the cup after the supper, saying, 'This cup is God's new covenant, sealed with my blood, which is poured out for you.'" Luke chapter 22, verses 19 and 20. He was sharing with his disciples a cup of wine, just as in the betrothal ceremony of a Jewish wedding. In a sense, they were entering into a marriage covenant with Jesus. He would shortly pay the price to win them and us by giving his very life for them. And what does he expect of us? In the betrothal contract, we accept Christ into our lives. We have received the Bible as a sort of covenant contract outlining what he will do for us and what he expects from us in return. It outlines our salvation, his plan for us, and how he expects us to love one another. Jesus would also follow that up after the resurrection by giving them and us the gift of the Holy Spirit. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 1 verses 20 to 22, "It is God himself who makes us, together with you, sure of our life in union with Christ. It is God himself who has set us apart, who has placed his mark of ownership upon us, and who has given us the Holy Spirit in our hearts as the guarantee of all he has in store for us." And remarkably, Jesus went on at the Last Supper to say, "Do not be worried and upset. Believe in God and believe also in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house, and I am going to prepare a place for you. I would not tell you this if it were not so. And after I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to myself, so that you will be where I am." John 14 verses 1 to 3. This sounds just like the Jewish bridegroom going off to prepare a room in his Father's house for his bride. Paul goes on later in 2 Corinthians in chapter 5 verses 1 to 9. "For we know that when this tent we live in, our body here on earth, is torn down, God will have a house in heaven for us to live in, a home he himself has made, which will last forever. And now we sigh, so great is our desire that our home, which comes from heaven, should be put on over us. By being clothed with it, we shall not be without a body. While we live in this earthly tent, we groan with a feeling of oppression. It is not that we want to get rid of our earthly body, but that we want to have the heavenly one put on over us, so that what is mortal will be transformed by life. God is the one who has prepared us for this change, and he gave us his Spirit as the guarantee of all that he has in store for us. So we are always full of courage. We know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord's home. For our life is a matter of faith, not of sight. We are full of courage and would much prefer to leave our home in the body and be at home with the Lord. More than anything else, however, we want to please him, whether in our home here or there." Jesus at the Last Supper said, "There are many rooms in my Father's house." The only other time he spoke of his Father's house, he was referring to the temple in Jerusalem. The point about the temple within the life of the people of Israel was that it was the place where they saw God dwelling in some special way, where heaven and earth met. Here Jesus seems to be hinting at a new city, a new world, a new house. Heaven and earth will meet again when God renews the whole world. At that time, there will be room for everyone who comes to him. Matthew records Jesus also saying at the Last Supper, "I tell you, I will never again drink this wine until the day I drink the new wine with you in my Father's kingdom." Surely that means we are still living in the period of betrothal, and the marriage is still to come. You will remember how in Paul's letter to the Ephesians he spoke of how Christ loved the church and gave his life for it. He did this to dedicate the church to God by his word, after making it clean by washing it in water, in order to present the church to himself in all its beauty, pure and faultless, without spot or wrinkle or any other imperfection. Ephesians 5 verses 25 to 27. You could say we are still a work in progress, but we are members of his body and united to him, and he is working out his good purposes in us. Which brings us to the marriage of Christ with his people after the time that the trumpet shall sound. We read in 1 Corinthians 15 verses 51 to 54. Listen to this secret truth. We shall not all die, but when the last trumpet sounds, we shall all be changed in an instant, as quickly as the blinking of an eye. For when the trumpet sounds, the dead will be raised, never to die again, and we shall all be changed. For what is mortal must be changed into what is immortal. What will die must be changed into what cannot die. So when this takes place, and the mortal has been changed into the immortal, then the scripture will come true. Death is destroyed. Victory is complete. Or again in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. Our friends, we want you to know the truth about those who have died, so that you will not be sad as those who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will take back with Jesus those who have died believing in him. What we are teaching you now is the Lord's teaching. We who are alive on the day the Lord comes will not go ahead of those who have died. There will be the shout of command, the archangel's voice, the sound of God's trumpet, and the Lord himself will come down from heaven. Those who have died believing in Christ will rise to life first. Then we who are living at that time will be gathered up along with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. So then, encourage one another with these words. The Lord Jesus will return to this earth bodily to usher in God's kingdom in its fullness, embracing earth and heaven. There will be the marriage supper of the Lamb, the union of Christ and his bride, the Church. You can read all about it in Revelation chapter 21. It is a story of creation healed and restored.
Love.
Let us pray. Our loving Lord, we thank you that you seek to draw us to yourself so that we might find our life in you. Your love rests upon us, and you desire to work out your good purposes in our lives. Help us to remember, however, that our relationship with you also involves others around us who are also members of your body. For you are drawing out a new people to celebrate your love and share your love. Lord Jesus, may you be our peace as you break down any dividing walls of hostility and make us into one new people, united in yourself. We long for that day when creation is healed and restored. Come, Lord Jesus, to transform us into the people you would have us be. Lord, speak to us through your church and the fellowship of others. Speak to us in the seasons, the landscape, and the weather. Speak to us in the stories of old and the words of the prophets. Speak to us through the leadership and ministries of today. Loving God, you have called us to be a living community, a people bound together as the body of Christ and a family united in love. Yet, Lord, in our broken world, so many are suffering, so many are hurting. We pray for those whose lives are ruled by hate and vengeance rather than love and justice. For those whose homes are not places of love or safety, but places of fear and violence. For those who have no home to speak of and have become invisible on our streets. For those who are stigmatized because of status, ill health, ethnicity, religion. Lord, you asked us to love our neighbors, all of them, not just the ones we choose. Enable us and equip us to carry out your command and to make a positive difference in the lives of those who are our neighbors and are struggling. We pray for all those in our congregations and communities who are ill at home or in hospital. Bring your healing hands and soothing balm upon them. We pray for all who are anxiously awaiting treatment, results, or appointments. For anxious relatives and carers who are exhausted with no rest and end in sight, and with the much-needed care packages few and far between. Lord, equip us as your people to assist them in their time of need. Enable us to be beacons of light to those going through dark days. Inspire us to be willing advocates for truth, justice, and reconciliation. Hate does not lay a healthy soil for love to grow and flourish, but rather stepping forward in faith and trust in you, Lord Jesus. You call us to make a positive difference and to heal your broken world of its hurt and its divisions. May we put our trust in you. Amen. And now may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.